The Rebel, 叛逆者, has finished airing at the end of June, and this is the final review on the drama. Hi, you're watching Avenue X, where Junkie on Good Storytelling shares her thoughts, knowledge, and occasional weird ideas on stories and how they're told. The 43-episode drama that's being aired on both web platforms and CCTV 8 in China has concluded. First, my final rating for this drama will stay at 2 gold mine. Although it hasn't gotten the highest possible rating from Avenue X, I would still say this is the best espionage drama set in Republic of China that I've seen in the last 3 years. I've gotten emails from people asking me about particular words or what is going on because they're not very familiar with the political background that the drama is set in. This is a very concise, very, very concise explanation. The year 1912 is the founding year of Republic of China. At the time, the official party that's in office is the Nationalist Party or Kuomintang, which is also what most of the characters belong to in this drama, including Lin Nansheng, Chen Moqun, Wang Shi, and all of them. Between the 1912 and 1949, that is the party in office, at least technically or theoretically, because during this time it was very turbulent. There were different warlords fighting at places, there are different parties, and even within the Nationalist Party at the time, there are many, many different power groups fighting against each other. But let's say from 12 to 49, 37 years, Nationalist Party, Kuomintang, is the official party running the country. Chinese Communist Party was founded in 1921. So it's a younger party by its birth date. And during those 37 years, there was about a third of that when the two parties are in collaboration. Two major periods. One is called 第一次国共合作, the first time the Nationalist Party and Communist Party worked together. That was between 1924 and 1927. Then the second time, collaboration happened between 37 to 46. Apart from those periods, Chinese Communist Party was pretty much the underground party. It's been hunted down by the Nationalist Party, and a lot of very horrendous murders, massacres, tortures happened in history. That is why in the drama you will hear the Nationalist Party members, the characters, would call the Communist Party bandits or underground, because that was during the time when the two parties are at throat with each other. Then there was a time in the drama because of Japanese invasion war, so pretty much from the official big outbreak of the war, 37 to the end, 45. During those years, it is officially collaboration time. On surface, there's no hunting you down stuff going on, but the parties are not really friends, let's just say. Then after Japan's surrender, things got back to I'll kill you and I'll hunt you to the end of the world, leading up to 3 years of full-on civil war within China, eventually leading to 49, a overall success of the Communist Party, and then the Nationalist Party is kicked out. And then that's the story of Taiwan. So yeah, that's like the very, very rough sketched out time frame. So hopefully that helps you to understand why the characters do the things they do and are like the way they are. Now, talking about the drama itself. First, I'll talk about the things that I think it could do better, and if they did, it probably will be a 3 gold mine. See if you have the same reaction as I do. First, I'm not happy about the ending. The ending is intentionally done in a very, very vague, ambiguous way. A lot of people were arguing online about whether the female lead actually survived. Did she actually physically appear in front of Lin Nansheng and then they were sitting in the courtyard and singing the songs? Was it totally just an imagined scene that happened in Lin Nansheng's head? Because of the camera language, the editing, the music, the style, the pace, it does give you that feeling is, I don't want to be clear. It's like the director is telling the audiences, go figure. I don't think that many people really care about whether it's a HE happy ending or a BE bad ending, because of that particular turbulent time, we pretty much accept that most people wouldn't end up with a good ending. It's a part of the reality, really, living at that time and doing what they do. I do understand why productions tend to do that, because they don't want to offend people. But then, a part of being a creator is like, you have to have the guts to stand, right, for your own expressions and ideas. It's like, this is my opinion, you know, like it or not. If you don't like it, you can disagree with it, it can go away. But I am not gonna be writing on a wall. I want this side, but I want that side too. I personally am not a fan of that. It's not a huge problem, but I do prefer actually give me a very clean cut ending about who is who and what is what and who ended up where. And I can accept anybody die in this drama, honestly, because it is the type of drama that you totally expect such things happening. The second thing about this drama is although its espionage plot is written pretty well, there's definitely still room for improvement. The point that I still feel most uncomfortable in the entire game of espionage is that around the female lead's first big challenge and failure is she returned. And supposedly she should go to her safe house and disappear. If you go back, you probably die and you probably get tortured and you may sell out your friends and comrades, because who knows whether you can take it. Particularly if you are already a qualified member of the underground sort of force and kind of always doing that job, you have the idea about what you are in for. A lot of people, you know, try to explain it away for the character. I still think the why she got back is not 100% convincing. It does feel like it's written because if it's not written in this way, the later plot would not happen. So that's one of those things within the story. There are a couple of more smaller things that happens which I would seriously consider, yeah, probably wouldn't happen realistically, but then if it doesn't happen, the plot wouldn't move forward. Then the third thing that I hope the drama could have done better is the female lead characters writing. So it's mostly to do with the script. She's been written as too perfect a character. Her name is literally Zhu Yizhen, which sounds like Zhu Yizhen, which is her ideology, is true. Pretty much everybody in this drama, their name can be interpreted when you change a little bit of the pronunciation of the name, meaning a different word. As a written character in the story, she has the problem, classic problem, as being the perfect character-wise, moral-wise, value-wise lead character. It becomes very bland and uninteresting. If you compare her character with the character Lan Xinjie, played by Zhu Zhu, you can immediately see the difference. Although the other female character is not a lead character, she has very limited screen time. Her storyline is very condensed, but every scene that she's in, she shows up, there's something interesting happening. And overall, her arc is a much more exciting arc as a character. And this is also the classic problem of often you have supporting roles that are much more interesting to look at. Towards the end of the drama, I did feel, I almost hoped Lan Xinjie is the female lead character. I almost hoped she would be the love interest of Lin Nansheng, because she's such a vibrant, real person in comparison to the almost made into a symbol female lead character. So this drama gives us a very classic situation that happens to a lot of story writings everywhere, not just in China, everywhere in cinema, in dramas. We tend to have much more interesting supporting roles than main roles. Plus, Tong Yao's natural demeanor and the style of her acting and even the styling of her character makes that even more pronounced, making a Zhu Yizhen character too mute, too agreeable, and therefore leaving very soft and erasable impression in the audience's mind. At least that is how intuitively I would receive her character. Plus, honestly, she really doesn't have that much screen time either. This drama is definitely mainly focused on the guys in this drama, and particularly on Zhu Yilong's character. So those are the things, after watching the whole drama, that I think affected my rating of Rebel, not giving it the highest score possible. But then the good things about this drama, there are obviously many. The first thing about this drama that makes it so watchable, and I watch it daily when it updates and never dropped it for one day, is great casting for all the roles, main, supporting alike. And for the core supporting roles, Gu Shenyan, Chen Moqun, Wang Shi'an, these three particularly, And I maintain my opinion, as I've said in my first review, I think those supporting roles made this drama. The drama. The second thing that this drama did really well is it actually has a lot of details, but you kind of have to be an expert of Chinese history to spot all the details this drama provides you. At what time, what year, what historical events happened and leading to particular things being mentioned in people's conversation, particular products being used, what is the streetscape, the props that are possible to show up, the newspapers that actually comes from history, the particular brands that are on the street that is actually researched and stuff. A lot of those details everywhere. It shows this drama's production has very good working ethic. We're doing this, so we should do a proper job. If this is set in 1939 at this month, then what could happen in the cinema, for example? What could be showing? What kind of things can be happening? What cannot? We have to put that detail in the drama, and 99% of the people will not care about that, not notice that. But for that 1% people who do notice, Easter egg. That's definitely a thumb up for the entire production crew. Then there's another thing that this drama I think did very well, that made this drama very well accepted too. That is to do with the character arc of the main lead character Lin Nansheng, played by Zhu Yilong. In many previous espionage dramas set in a particular time and historical background, you inevitably have to come across the type of plot where often a nationalist party member character eventually turns onto the communist party side. This plot pretty much happens in every espionage drama at some point, okay? But often it happens because for convenience sake it has to happen. Dramas do not put energy, and also they're not very good at convincingly showing you about this particular character, all the stages they have to go through, all the challenges, all the doubt they had, all the obstacles they run into, that eventually lead them to just gradually shift their direction and decided to take the other way. This type of big choice in your life that's life and death important is not something that can be taken lightly. If you say a character falls in love with another character who is on the other side and immediately shifts their allegiance, which happens so many times in this type of dramas, it just is not convincing at all. Whereas in this drama, Lin Nansheng as the main character, you see the full arc of where he started, all the stages, all the things that he had to experience, and the pains and the doubt and losing people along the way, people who are important to him. You see that entire arc being so carefully presented to you. And at every important turning point, something knocks on it and turns it a little bit, knocks on it, turns on it a little bit. So eventually when he got to the point that he's so disappointed in Kuomintang, that he's like, you people are ridiculous. When the country is under threat of invasion, when everybody is like struggling to survive, you only care about internal fights and money and how to climb up the ladder. You don't care about the people who are suffering all the time. I've had enough. I decide I'm gonna take the other approach. By the time he makes that decision, it is so sold, okay? It has been fully explained. And I think it's very rare in this type of drama. Cannot think of another drama that has actually done this so well. So for that one thing, it deserves a thumb up. Also, as the main actor, Zhu Yilong, I said in the first impression that it depends on how he acts in later episodes that I can form a full opinion. And after I made the first impression, immediately actually the plot got to the point where his first stage ended and he got a little bit promotion within his organization, and it's now full-on Japanese invasion war. And we see him again as the team leader. And immediately when that time gap happened, I feel so much more comfortable with his acting because he has started to become a much more assured person of what he wants and what he can do. The way he walks, the way he talks to other people, the way he looks at other people is no longer the timid newbie. The acting immediately feels much better. Because honestly, Zhu Yilong is, you know, how old? 33 now, and playing a very, very young newbie, it is quite actually off from his aura. Because he is the through-line character, so he does have the majority of screen time, particularly in a later stage of the drama. You do see more space for the actor to play things, and there are definitely certain scenes that he did really well. So overall, very happy about the rebel because this year is the 100-year anniversary of Communist Party founding in China. So there are many, many different types of stuff that is about this theme, dramas, films, all kinds of smaller, bigger productions here and there. We haven't seen all of them yet. And there are a couple of films that are ongoing in China that I can't watch because I'm not in China. So it is still too early to conclude which particular, say, work is the best. I know there is a drama that is very well received in China called 觉醒年代, probably will take the first place. But I have the high hope that this drama probably will take the second place within this package of all the cultural creations for this particular purpose and theme. So that should conclude this final review on the drama, The Rebel, 叛逆者. Thank you for watching Avenue X. I'll see you in my next video. Meanwhile, live long and happy drama watching.